Well, good afternoon, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us today for the first President's Leadership Lecture Series for this fall. I am Jody Gordon. I'm the Vice President's students here at UFV, and it's my pleasure to be your MC today. I wish to take this opportunity to acknowledge UFV as being situated on the unceded traditional territory of the Stalo people. UFV recognizes and honors the Aboriginal people have made, the contributions they have made and continue to make in our community. The university supports Indigenous learners and seeks to incorporate Indigenous ways of knowing in our curriculum. I express my gratitude and respect for being here with all of you today. The format today is that our Vice Chancellor and President, Dr. Mark Everett, will introduce the President's Leadership Lecture Series and our speaker, 2014 Honorary Doctorate Degree recipient, Dr. Charllotte Kwon. After Dr. Kwon's presentation, there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions. I would now like to call our UFV Vice Chancellor and President, Dr. Mark Everett, to come forward and introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Jody. Don't applaud me, save that for the speaker. She's going to be much better. Well, I'm absolutely delighted to welcome Dr. Kwon back to her alma mater as an alumna of the University of the Fraser Valley. I say that because, of course, she received an honorary doctorate from this university and is now reclaim one of ours. I established the President's Leadership Lecture Series a few years back because we wanted an opportunity to come together, community members, university, faculty, staff, and students, to have an opportunity to hear from some thought-provoking speakers, people who are going to inform us and enlighten us, entertain us, and provoke our thinking a little bit. Glad to see class must be out, is it? Or class is in. Well, let me tell you a little bit about Dr. Charllotte Kwon. Charllotte has been a tireless advocate for the preservation of tradition and crafts and the betterment of society. She's an artist, she's a documentary filmmaker, an educator, a businesswoman, a humanitarian, a philanthropist, and a social entrepreneur. I'm humbled. She embodies the commitment of the University of the Fraser Valley to changing lives in meaningful ways and building strong, sustainable communities. Charllotte tells us that she became intrigued by plant dyes while traveling in Indonesia, Thailand, and China. And everywhere in her travels, she found craftspeople doing incredible work, but struggling to find a market, a fair market, for their products. So she established the Maiwa Foundation, dedicated to the preservation of individual craft and to the employment, the empowerment, and the eradication of poverty in developing nations. The Maiwa Foundation, under Charllotte's leadership, helps fund practicing and re-emerging artisans, supports the development of higher order skills, and promotes economic self-sufficiency. For example, she raised funds to purchase lands in Dhamaka, India, with safe and secure water supply for the craftspeople there for the production of their cloth. She provided support for rebuilding after the 2001 earthquake in the Kutch region of India. The foundation has also provided support for international conferences for craftspeople to meet and exchange ideas. And it's a source of small grants to help craftspeople who need to build wells or buy a bike or wherever, whatever it is they need to help them continue their craft, make a living out of it, and share it with us. Charllotte is also the founder of the Maiwa Handprints Limited, a commercial enterprise with stores on Granville Island and East Vancouver, which provides an international market for artisans in developing countries that ensures fair wages and fair trade. She's authored numerous publications. She's published documentaries on textiles and dyeing. She's given numerous lectures, workshops, seminars, and exhibitions. Workshops in Canada and India, Morocco, Ethiopia, Mexico, Turkey, Laos. That's an old list. I've probably left half a dozen off. And teaches natural dyeing classes to artisans around the world. She's an innovative and social entrepreneur. For example, she's worked with UBC and a course in applied science called Innovative Socio-Technological Engineering, bringing artisan-related engineering problems to students to solve. She has phenomenal UFV connections. We're absolutely delighted with the connections and the service that Charllotte has provided us over the years. She supervises UFV fashion design students, practica. She mentored Carmen Jansen, one of UFV's stars, 2006 Garfield Weston scholarship recipient. She's employed our students, most notably Danielle Bush, who was a strong supporter of Charllotte's honorary doctorate. And she's been a major contributor to exhibitions in this community at the Reach Gallery here in Abbotsford, where UFV co-sponsored an event called Thread Textiles from Stalo, South Asian and Mennonite Communities. And needless to say, Charllotte's work and leadership there was greatly appreciated. Gail, I see you in the audience, Gail Ramston from our fashion design department was the lead nominator for Charllotte's award and used phrases such as unwavering commitment to place and community, a testament of humanity, and reminds us that Charllotte realized early on as a businesswoman that behind a finished piece, there's a person, a family, a community, and a way of life. I think she's going to speak to us now about slow clothes. Charllotte, welcome. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's very kind. Can you hear? Yes, I'm going to talk to you about slow clothes today. The term slow clothes was coined by our own Angela Murals, a journalist for the Georgia Strait. She based it on the concept of the slow food movement, which appeared as a reaction against fast food culture. The slow food movement emphasizes eating locally, organic, maintaining traditional regional cuisines, and maintaining the connection between the plate and the planet. There is also a fast clothes culture, and we all know it exists. It's created by the fashion industry, and it has broken down the connection between cloth and soul. At Maiwa, we believe that making clothes can be slowed down in very particular ways. There are well-known and heartbreaking issues of labor and exploitation in the fashion industry. There are many horror stories of working conditions and wages. Today, or this afternoon, I'd like to focus on a more positive side, what can be done and what we see being done. There is an alternative. Slow clothes are slow because there is human involvement in all aspects of production. And we see human involvement as not something to be eliminated in the interest of faster production. Far from it. We seek to add human element to all aspects of clothing design and clothing production. It's important to draw out what might be the obvious distinction. Slow clothes are not slow because production is inefficient or lacks planning. Slow clothes are slow because their production is thoughtful and quite simply requires time. For us, slow clothes is asking the question if we even need to produce another piece of clothing. And I believe that the answer is yes, but we need to do it differently. Every piece produced must make a difference. A different criteria must be met, and that's what I would like to explore with you today. You may think that slow clothes would be prohibitively expensive to make, but it's not true. The fact is that mass-produced jeans are inexpensive to make, but the consumer is willing to pay upwards of $300 a pair even in with knowing that in the back of our minds, it's less than 5% of what it costs is what's the ticketed price. At Maiwa, we know it's possible to make slow clothes because we do it all the time. It is challenging, it requires us to be clever and sharp and smart in a different way than is required of a fast clothes model. And yes, it takes time, but the benefits give us something that the ordinary clothing manufacturer will never have. An intense joy when we succeed, a feeling that we're doing something beyond being successful at a demanding business, a knowledge that we have been successful at making the clothing industry inclusive of artisans, craftspeople, and skilled technicians, and that we are able to keep them fully employed and maintaining of their skills. I'd like to take you through some of the aspects of slow clothes so that you can see what we mean. The title of the lecture is Waiting for the Monsoon, Slow Clothes in India, because we work in India, and the cycle of the monsoon absolutely affects our production in every way, from spinning and weaving to the growing of dyes, from the block printing to the sewing. The lights? Yeah.
Those really bright ones will affect my camera.
But okay.
How's the audience feel? You want me to turn the lights off? Yeah, okay.
Sorry. This is a factory weaving cloth at an astounding pace. We use mill-woven linen woven at this mill in Calcutta. But more than half of our clothing production uses hand-woven cloth. Some of our hand-woven cloth can take a village up to 1.5 years to weave. It has a life and a substance like no other cloth we've ever been able to find. We can get the most gossamer of cottons and over-twisted silk tussars. We can blend organic yarn with the metals of Nepal. We can take the threads of an Assami, Airy silk and blend it with Tibetan wool. And we can only do this in the hand-spun, hand-woven sector, for a mill wouldn't even look at our order. We can include artisans from all the places we work, and they can be part of the fashion industry that has traditionally excluded them because of the way the industry works, both to systems and to schedules. These artisans, by the very work they do and the very remoteness of their communities, have significant impact on maintaining diversity of fibers, diversity of seeds for fibers, processing for extracting fiber from plants. The village is a village, and it's very different from a factory. It lives and life continues. There are children and the elderly, there are the workers amongst it all. It is very easy to have your children beside you when you weave in your village. The work life and the home life coexist. This is Pitchy Reddy's indigo farm in the south of India, where we get all our natural indigo. All our blue color comes from this plant. As clothing designers and producers, we are very affected by the conditions of the farmers who cultivate our natural colors. We are brought into their weather issues and must constantly adjust our dye recipes with each crop. These two bullocks, they're hauling 2 tons of indigo leaves, which become 1 kilo of indigo powder. Maiwa uses natural dyes in 90% of its clothing and 100% of its bedding. There's an incredible connection between natural dyes and history, geography, culture, science, ecology, in a world absolutely saturated by synthetic color. It's imperative that natural dyes remain economically viable. We can't dye everything in our world with natural dyes. Our need for color is too great. But natural dyes do not have to disappear. All that knowledge of plants and water and land, of extracting color from nature, they must remain as a vibrant alternative. There is a connection between natural dyes and its source that simply does not exist with synthetic colors. In the north of India, on the Tibetan border, we work with a group of weavers who spin, weave, and naturally dye our wools and wool mixes such as tussar silk wool and muga silk wool. Tussa and muga are two of the wild silks. It's not possible for them to be spun or woven on mechanical looms, but they're just the most incredible fibers to blend. Some of these textiles, these wool blends, and well, this one here, they're making these, some small chair pads for us in this one with indigo dyed wool. And then you'll see some hand weaving of wool. Some of these go down to our village, our studio in Village Begru, just outside of Jaipur. And the artisans work them into garments that we've designed. Some of them go into shawls, some of them into blankets, and get fully finished in this village. We also work in Kutch, which is on the Pakistan border, the Kutch Desert. And we work with weavers who weave a slightly rough, textural, local wool. From this, we also make blankets and shawls, and we have a line of incredible coats out of this fabric. The dyes are mostly from indigo for blue and lac for burgundy reds. And when they're set against the natural shades of the natural brown and the natural blacks of the wool of the local sheep, they're just stunning. We work with block printers in various parts of India, from the Kutch Desert bordering Pakistan to Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh in the center, Andhra Pradesh in the south. All of our surface design fabrics of printing comes from block printing with natural dyes, all done on organic cotton, linen, or silk. This process can be simple and serene, or highly complex, with patterns taking up to 15 passes of the cloth under the block and through the dye bath. Block printers are constantly designing, constantly putting repeats together, innovating, and we keep pushing the benchmark. This is what keeps people highly skilled. It's interesting, I keep referring to, we were just talking in the last class, I refer to artisan a lot, and sometimes people will think of that being artisan as in single people or single or one-off pieces of fabric or one-off clothing. But it's interesting to note that the single Maiwa store on Granville Island supports the natural dyeing block printing of 30,000 meters in the Kutch Desert, 35,000 meters in Rajasthan, and 10,000 meters in South India. Maiwa also supports the hand weaving of over 30,000 meters in various parts of India, from Bengal to Himachal to Tamil. 100% of this fabric is certified organic, locally produced, and has such value added that rather than getting the standard $1.05 for a meter of cotton and $1.50 for a meter of silkscreen cotton, for instance, These artisans, producers, get $4.25 for organic cotton and $9.50 for a meter when it's block printed. We're extremely interested in the process of creation and production, in the origin and history of a fiber, of a fabric, of a process. We're interested in the connection of cultures and people to trade, and to textiles' ability to communicate simple beauty, intrinsic original qualities, textiles and clothing that make you want to touch them, to know who's made them, who has woven the cloth, and who has created these colors. We are interested in making beautiful things rather than instantly recognizable labels. And we're interested in creating a connection between the maker and the wearer. We collaborate with artisans who are actively involved in all levels of our clothing, from their particular process, which in this case is embroidery, right through to the costing and selling. This was a catalog we did of an exhibition that these women did of some of their, of a lot of their work. It was at the Vancouver Museum. It was their highest attended exhibit. And it went on from 6 months to 2 years. And it was called Through the Eye of the Needle, Stories from an Indian Desert. We also bring artisans to the West so they can see where their art goes, who buys it, better understand their market. For those of you who attend our Maiwa Symposium, we have had many of the artisans come out. Also, for those of you who have joined me on a tour, you've met many of them yourselves and right in the village. In the south of India, in the Munnar Hills, deep in the tea plantations, we work with a group of natural dyers who use tea waste to dye silks and organic cotton. After working with them for some time now, we're able to give them our patterns of garments, and they can design the fabric using their wealth of skill with tying and binding, with batik, block printing, and natural dyes. Because this is the Tata Tea Fields, we've had a lot of support in this particular, with this particular group from Tata, which is a huge steel company in India. So they've been able to build all the machinery we could ever dream of. It's been fabulous. They've had some challenges with light fastness with their product. And on one of the trips, we took our master dyer Mahesh from village Bagru and our indigo farmer Pitchy Reddy, plus two of our Vancouver Maiwa staff, to help troubleshoot some of their issues. You'll meet them in a sec. For those that do dyeing, this is like a dream studio, as they've got a piece dyeing machine here that Tata Steel built, and a 25,000 liter indigo dye vat, which we mentioned and was there by the next time we got there. So this is Mahesh from village Bagru, and this is Pitchy Reddy on the right, our indigo farmer. So when they had this problem and when we noticed they had some light fast problems, we didn't just walk away and say, sorry, your dyes are fading and this is not acceptable to us. Instead, we said, your dyes are fading and I think we know some experts who can help with that. And they found this very different. In our rapidly cycling fashion industry, we're losing the human touches, and we're most interested in putting the human touch back into every garment, into the fabric, the colors, the stitching, the details. We feel very responsible for the people involved in every step and are often drawn into their issues. We work very collaboratively, and we feel deeply that we all must come up together. Now we've arrived at the Maiwa studio in village Bagru. This is where we began our clothing production in India and began to try working with the idea of bringing together a whole diverse group of textile artisans who work independently in their villages and try having them work collaboratively on lines of clothing. They work from great distances, but in constant communication. At first, we tried a pretty traditional industrial model of clothing production based on garment dyeing, making garments, and dyeing in the garment stage. This just didn't work for natural dyes. The dyes have a larger molecule than synthetic dyes, and the dye didn't go into the seams as we would have liked it. We then tried piece dyeing or fabric dyeing because we work with fabrics other than cottons. We work with linens, hemps, wools, heavy silks, alternative fibers and fabrics that tend to be heavy when wet. The dyers could only work with 3 to 5 meter pieces rather than 25 to 30 meter pieces. So we ended up with a process of cutting each piece of fabric for each garment and working this way. It was an organizational challenge, let me tell you. Here's some of the dyes that we work with: Myra Ballin, Majeet Matter. This is a clay, turmeric, alum, a bioaccumulator plant of alum. And these are the storerooms of our dyes. We were talking in the last class how now we buy entire crops, and when a crop is very, very strong, we'll keep it and we'll combine it. We're a bit like vintners, you know, we'll combine one year with another. It's been really a huge learning curve, and it's been wonderful. This kind of gives you an idea of how it's just small blocks that block the fabric, but it's how you can, it's one way of working with natural dyes, and it's also how you can create that really wonderful variegation of a fabric. And this is Dabu, which is mud, and this area where we have our studio, Begru, is very famous for its mud. It has a tactile quality that once it dries, you can put it through a dye bath and it'll stick. That's why block printing became famous in this area and why we chose this area to continue the block printing tradition. So that block of mud is resisting, and then it'll go into the indigo vat and they'll dye a darker indigo. So the mud is a local mud with a mealy wheat and some calcium and jaggery, which is a type of sugar. These are some traditional patterns. We'd worked with the village for about 6 years with Begru, and then we went to a museum and they dug out some of the traditional patterns from this village. And we decided to do an entire line of garments with the traditional old patterns from Village Begru, and it was a huge hit, both locally and in Vancouver. This is our red, our madder, which is a root, and because it responds to copper, all the madder is dyed in copper pots. One of our staff went, actually I think it was Danny, why do we put wash gently on our labels after she saw them whacking this? So this is some of the garments from coming out from a few years ago. This is very interesting. This is pomegranate. This is how we get our grays and our lovely, what we've become quite famous for, taupey browns and cement putty colors. But this is an iron pot and pomegranate skins. And the pomegranate skins are high in tannin, and they react to the water that's been sitting in an iron pot. And it's how we get these lovely, lovely colors of grays and silvers. And this is indigo, the famous indigo, the only way of getting blue naturally, historically and naturally. And this is one of our indigo dyers. This is our oldest indigo dyer, and he's very affectionately called Indigo Kaka, which is Uncle Indigo. So this is the indigo from the farm that you saw earlier from Pitchy Reddy's farm. And this is a fully natural indigo vat that's 10 feet deep. So you can put a whole bed sheet or a whole one of our pieces of fabric, 3-meter pieces of fabric in there to over dye it with blue. And this 10-foot bat, we have 10 of them. They go from monsoon to monsoon. So we build it after the end of the monsoon, and it continues to be fed with all kinds of substances that require an indigo bat, and it goes until the beginning of the next monsoon. At Maiwa, we seem at times to be on a mission of promoting the so-called imperfect, rather like having to explain organic apples with their inherent spots or various sizes. Unlike processed foods, organic foods have an identity. You know they have been grown on a farm. They haven't been overly designed or controlled or modified. And there's a beauty to the imperfections. We are always trying to help people understand the beauty of hand-spun and hand-woven, the inherent slubs and variegations of fabric that give it life and beauty. The color that comes with using plant dyes, color that's not perfectly even, but it shifts across the fabric with subtle shades. And God forbid it fades with age, but it fades beautifully, and it gives the fabric sophistication and patina. This is Masi Debbie, who pulls out all our bandhani ties. So this is all tied to give the dots. It's called bandhani or shibori. And then they all have to get pulled out. It's like a very fun job. It's like popping bubbles. So this is our linen and cotton lining, and just how challenging it is to get two different fibers of similar color. Clothing is fundamental. The basic needs of food, shelter, and clothing have remained unaltered throughout time. What has changed is the vast amount of marketing power that has transformed these basic needs into excessive demands. I do believe the clothing industry can make great changes for good, but it will take the demand of the buying public. That's how it works. It has the power to affect employment by including skilled communities rather than always moving towards the factory. It can positively affect farming in a way that it can be inclusive if it remains diversified. It can have a positive effect on the environment in its solid support of organic textiles and natural dyes. It can support alternative fibers, alternative sources of natural color. What gets me is that there is this idea or this illusion of so much diversity in fashion, and yet the reality is there is less and less room for the inclusion of the very artisans and small producers that could make it diverse and would most benefit from being part of the clothing production. It is, however, the consumer who has ultimate power for good by buying better. We are in constant dialogue to remain creative and responsive in our production methods, to be able to work with hundreds of weaves, so many natural dyes, fibers, so many types of fabrics. It's interesting to note that in all, on average, we work with 1,200 embroiderers, 400 weavers, 100 block printers, 100 natural dyers, 50 sewers in full-time employment. This is our sample room in Baguio. our pattern room and sample room. Much like the slow food revolution, we do need a slow clothes revolution, a greater understanding of the real cost of clothing and an appreciation of their value. The eco message is to buy less and buy better. Buy less by making the most of what you have. Borrow and recycle clothing. In the last decade, as the price of clothing has fallen, women have doubled the size of their wardrobe and not reduced the actual amount they spend on clothing. The defense of overproduction to create more affordable clothing then just doesn't stick. Buy better by choosing fairly traded clothing, clothes from natural fibers and pesticide-free fibers, naturally dyed textiles, artisan and handcrafted details. Slow clothes by buying proactively and thoughtfully. We're sending the message that current exploitative practices is simply unacceptable and that we're prepared to put our money where our mouth is and support the positive alternative. A slow clothes movement can mean buying locally, make your own clothing, buying less, buying clothes that last and remain classic, buying clothes that are inclusive of communities. Professor Barry Schwartz of Swarthmore College in Pennsylvania and author of The Paradox of Choice, Why More is Less, said in an interview, and I just love this, fashion has always been wasteful, and now we just waste faster. All this massive quantity of choice and product is a triumph of marketing, not necessarily a triumph of aesthetics. The slow clothes movement gives us the opportunity to explore a language other than one of commerce, other than one that is engineered to describe the bottom line, the purpose of something. Since someone makes money each time we buy a pair of jeans, there is a whole language around getting us to buy more jeans. The language is a language of persuasion, of commerce, and has actually little to do with the clothing as an expression of who we are. But there is an increasingly lost language of subtleties, pleasures, associations, meanings of the handcrafted, hand-detailed, plant-dyed, the hand-woven, the created, the human experience of clothing the body. Rebecca Solnit writes in her book, A Field Guide to Getting Lost, "Ultimately, I believe that slowness is an act of resistance. Not because slowness is good in itself, but because of all that it makes room for, the things that don't get measured and can't be bought." At Maiwa, we seek slow clothes as a movement of making room in the clothing industry for the human endeavor of creativity, of clothing with ethical and social significance, clothing with subtle details that infuse a cloth with meaning, clothing enriched by handcraft details, clothing with soul. Thank you very much.
Well, Dr. Kwon, thank you so much for inspiring us to think about how we purchase our clothes and the fabrics we buy, and for introducing us to slow clothes. It's had a powerful impact on the audience. So now it's the audience's turn to ask some questions. We do have a roaming mic that will move around, so if you could just wave if you wish to ask Dr. Kwon a question, and we'll find you with the mic, and you've still got your headset on?
Yeah.
Perfect. So down front here, thank you.
How do they get paid? or how do they get income from this all?
Well, you got to be prepared to work for not too much at the beginning, but I don't have a lot of financial ambition, but I don't come from anything either. We started this on three. Oh, how do they?
Yeah, yeah.
How do they? Because we pay them. So they're basically their partners with us. So one third of the price, the retail price that you see on any of our clothing or shawls or anything, goes to them. That's how our costing works. One third goes to us, and one third goes to Canada Customs, British Airways, all the ways that we get it to get it here.
Other questions?
Any other questions? Yes.
Way at the back.
At the back here?
Yes. Hi, Dr.
Dami. How do you do the marketing about this?
Here. Everything comes here. We don't sell anything in India. We have done conventional marketing with magazine ads and newspapers and all of that. It's so incredibly expensive. All our marketing now is done with social media or online, through our blog, through our online store, our website. I go to everywhere I could possibly go and speak. We have a fantastic staff of 32 that are highly knowledgeable about everything. They go to India, they work in the village, they're really engaged. Yeah, I don't find conventional ways of marketing, but I can tell you that we can't produce enough. We have wholesalers that are lined up to buy from us. We can't produce enough to sell to them. But when one wholesaler is no longer, wants to move on or isn't working with us, then the next person comes up and they're always really thrilled when they get that call and we say, you know, if you're still interested in wholesaling with us, we have room now. We can't produce. We produce about 35,000 garments a year. We don't really want to get any bigger. There's lots of room for competition. There's lots of room for people to do what we do, and we'd love to see that, and we try to engage people in that all the time. This kind of work is an amazing life. I love my life. We all love our lives. It's wonderful to work in the village with the artisans and see their lives and them loving that relationship and coming to become so strong. We used to see that we used to think that we would need to work with a group for about 8 years before they were on their feet and able to wholesale or able to produce for other people, but it became 15 years and nobody left, no group left working with us. Now it's 20 years, well it's 30 years, but 20 years later, some groups are just starting to be able to, like it's inside them. They're on their feet and they're actually selling to Japan or to Australia. We don't get involved, they can do whatever. We don't hold on to any patterns or designs, or they can use our garment patterns, they can use, it's their work. We're loving and we're in love with their work. We're not inventing anything. A dress is a dress, a shirt is a shirt. So they can use all of that. And we were surprised to find that it took 20 years. But the marketing isn't something we're seeking as in being global. It doesn't work for this way of doing business.
You guys are making
Thank you so much for a wonderful presentation. I'm looking at what I have on and thinking about my closet and thinking, the things that I've purchased that have been manufactured in the way you're speaking of, I'm afraid to use because they are so valuable and pretty. Can you just elaborate on how the lives of the people in these villages have changed?
It's probably one of the most inspiring things. You can tell I love photographing. I love documenting. I'm always photographing them. And in India, there's always an issue, with kids because they always want to be in every shot. So I always take time, I've learned to take time to photograph the kids first, and then I can be free in the village a bit more. And I find an interesting thing is that before, I used to say, what do you want to be photographed with? And they would say, they'd go get their new plastic bucket or maybe a bicycle or a cell phone or something. And now, 100%, they want to be, can I be block printing? Can you take a photo of me block printing? Can you take a photo of me embroidering? Even a young boy will do that. And they are so proud of their parents. And they see what their parents have accomplished. Parents always, all over the world, would want to, you know, you'd still ask them and their parents would still say, what do you want your kids to be? A doctor, prime minister of India, you know, whatever. We say that too. Their kids, though, they know what their hand, before they were working with us, they would never want their kids to be a block printer or an embroiderer. They just like, no. Now they go, okay, yeah, I see. It's a skill now. It's not child abuse by handing that skill on where they're never going to get a job. They're actually seeing how they're creating a job for their family. And we don't ever go, we never take people out of the village and set up even when we have a studio in Baguio, that's just where we finish everything. So the artisans can come, there's a flat there, they can stay there, they can drop off their fabric, they can learn how to sew. Some of them have learned how to do the export quality edging for bedding. Nobody's really doing too much sewing of clothing yet, but they can come and learn that process. But they can bring things or ship things or whatever, but they stay in the village and they stay. Really, migrating to the city is never a good thing. So, their lives are with their hard work, we're all working super hard at this. So they take risks, we take risks, but they know that they're coming up. One of the biggest things is their fear, particularly after the earthquake there, is the fear, they know that an earthquake is going to hit here. You know, so they're always, you know, anytime there's any kind of thing going on in California, whatever, the earthquake, they're always going, is Maiwa okay? Is the shop okay? They know exactly where their things are. They know exactly what it costs to get there, what people are buying. We have this kind of campaign for people to send us pictures of the bedding in their homes and the clothes on them. I'm acutely aware of the fact that I'm taking what was a market within their country and we're exporting it. So because the work is high value and they can't, there's very little local market. They need to, at this point, export. But I'm acutely aware of the fact that they don't get to meet their customers. So we try to find all kinds of ways, taking tours there, having them come here, having them speak and then go and talk to, you know, village by village. They go and take their photos and they go and speak about their experience here. Sending photos of their work in other people's homes and how does that work. So, yeah, it's a journey and we're all on it. It's never a given. There's never a system. We're always, you know, this woman, I've told this story before, but this woman met me on a bus in Kutch, and she just, I know, I'm very bad with languages. I can get along in Hindi. I can barely get along in Kutchy. And she just lost it on me on a bus. She was really angry, really mad, and she knew who I was, and I couldn't understand her, and I'm trying to ask people on the bus, what's wrong? Why is she yelling at me? And I finally got somebody. We stopped actually, I knew Ishmabai was at the bus stop, and I said, Ishmabai, you've got to help me understand why this woman's so upset. And she was upset because our orders had got so big that they could no longer get the fabric in this area for their weddings. And they needed that. And everybody, the group that we were working with usually makes their wedding cloth. And now they couldn't get that. And this group didn't have the nerve to tell me or us that, well, we can't actually finish your work right now. We'd like to you know, because we have to do the wedding season. Wedding season is really big in India, and it's quite long. It comes up several times a year. So, you know, it's never a given that we're doing the right thing, ever. And I was like, oh my God, we need to talk about this. But nobody wanted to talk with us because the Dematka, the family, they didn't want to risk us not producing order. We wanted our order at a certain time. I said, no, we don't. We can actually shift how we do our orders. Absolutely. We don't actually have to have them come at this time. We can shift it by 3 months. You can do the wedding season. And, you know, everybody's relieved. But if you're not on the ground, if you're sitting in an office in Delhi and you're not on the ground watching what's happening, you don't know your impact. But your impact is an impact, no matter it can be positive or negative. And I love that. I love that conversation. I'm never feeling like I know everything or that we have a system down pat that works for them, works for us. You know, we can repeat it and we can sell all over the world. No, those conversations are actually lost when you expand and you get too big. And I'm very interested in our impact locally. And here, locally in both places, I'm very interested in whether our staff, you know, what our staff want or think or how their lives are unfolding by working for Maiwa, and how the people we work with and trade with, how their lives are unfolding. And then there's always people, you know, you can come and, okay, let's have a meeting. What's everybody want? More money. We want more money, higher wages, da-da-da-da. We need this, da-da-da. Okay, let's unpack all that. And let's look at the costing and let's see if there is more money. Okay, maybe there is, maybe there isn't. Let's all sit down and look at the costing. Costing is a huge, huge can of worms. And we head into it all the time. Everybody we work with, they all do the costing. And they all see how it affects at this end. And they have to learn why things sell and why their stuff is costing now out of the market, or why Meguben's stuff is not selling and Nanuben's stuff is selling. So, you know, and we have to sometimes go, well, you know, this may be a costing issue, maybe a color issue, maybe a quality issue, I don't know. So let's look at it.
I think we have another question.
I'd like you to, I mean, I think you were starting to get at this in your previous answer, but it seems to me that one of the tenets of the slow food movement, which you're using as a comparison, is local production and local markets. So how does that resonate with your kinds of endeavors? Is it different with textiles because the raw materials are being produced in places that aren't here? And then secondarily to that, you say, you know, there's no market for this stuff in India. I've been going back and forth to India for about 15 years now, and what I see among people my age is that there's a growing interest in these kinds of concerns. So I'm wondering, are you trying to sell to reach that market in India? Are you partnering up with Indian NGOs and fair trade? And, you know, what's that scenario like? Because it seems to me that it kind of fulfills that local bit that's sort of otherwise missing in this very powerful slow clothes analysis.
Yeah, no, very good points. So first, your first point with the slow foods movement, yeah, regional, and that's why I say, you know, part of the slow clothes movement is also buying from local designers, making your own clothes. There's many aspects. We're only just touching one aspect, and so because we're in this industry, and that's just the life I happen to have chosen and happen to love, and it takes all your life. It takes your total commitment to do what we're doing, and you gotta love it. You can't. And I went through a crisis in my 40s. You know, I'm in my late 50s now. I went through a crisis in my 40s where I thought, am I gonna do this for the rest of my life? I can't even walk away from these people anymore. I've committed, and I panicked, and got over it, and now I couldn't walk away for anything. I would never walk away. And yeah, I think that it's a comparison, but it's many faceted comparison. Slow clothes has and slow foods have many aspects that can be better understood and more support and so forth. And local is definitely one of them. The 100-mile diet, same with the 100-mile clothing. There can be all kinds of aspects to that that would be wonderful to explore for anybody. My choice is to explore this aspect. Which then takes us to your next question, which could we sell in India? We've thought about it, but we don't make any decision without talking to all the artisans we work with, and they're nervous about it because of the way things get copied and so forth. So it's not
And they feel they've developed some of these, well, all of the patterns, all of the textile patterns, none of them are our designs. The weave, sometimes because we've developed some of the complexity of the weaves, we have one weave, you know, that's, you know, 100 unrepeating stripes, you know, and so we've pushed and developed and supported them in developing some of the most complex of things. They get very worried about the copying aspect. And so that's, while there is a growing movement of it, I think it's being really fulfilled by some of the most fantastic designers coming up now are in India. Some of the most, you know, from Perro to Bappa Biswas to just, there's just so many great young designers. We're very open and collaborative with them, and we share a lot, and we get in touch with them, many of them, while we're traveling. We've opened villages that we work with. They've asked us, where are you getting this Azrak? And we just tell them, Dumadka, the absolute best Azrak you'll ever get. You should work with them. But what we've worked on, the artisans, we feel we can't make those decisions on our own, and there's not a single artisan that wants to sell locally. They want to continue with the exporting. Their children, on the other hand, maybe. We're seeing that the children are of the artisans that we work with, and many others are coming up as fantastic designers. And there's design schools. I mean, there's NID. There's so many great design schools in India that are producing some amazing designs. We've worked with them. They've come here. We've had them with practicums and that. We do tend to work pretty close to the ground in India. We're not. We work very remote and very much in the village, and we sit in the village, so we're not in the cities in Mumbai and Delhi and so forth, but that's just a choice. That's not a recommendation. It's not that I think it shouldn't be sold locally. I think that things are coming up locally. It's just a choice that we've made.
Other questions? I have a quick one for you.
Yeah.
There was a scene in your video of artisans looking at photos of, in a booklet from the museum, of their own work. And because there wasn't audio, what were they saying? What was their response to seeing their work treated as a piece of art?
Yeah, that whole journey was amazing, actually. It all came from a comment I happened to make in a village where I was so stunned. We push and push and push in India. In fact, I'm known, and I kind of wear it proudly. I was really insulted at the beginning, but I'm known as Mrs. Fussy Pushy. And they used to say that in Hindi till I learned Hindi, and then they were embarrassed. And I had pushed and pushed because I really believe in the quality. And I really believe that can't be copied. And now all Kutchi embroidery and most Rajasthani embroidery is being copied in India or copied in China. And it comes back into India at all the trade fairs. It's just so alarming right now. And but none of the work that we've worked with and the artisans we've worked with, nothing is copied. And one of the times when I went to the village, and I'm always like challenging them and stuff, I said, oh God, this is like museum quality. This is collector quality work. This is unbelievable. So they got really like, what do you mean? Why are you saying that? You know, they got it translated, and what does museum quality mean and that. And they said, so Charlotte, then make us a show. Do us a show. We should have a show. So I thought, yeah, they absolutely should. And I went to the Vancouver Museum, and we worked out a show. And so when they were, and they, 40 women, of about 1,200 women, 40 women were actually of the level that could do these. They didn't want their clothes done. They said, no, we don't want our clothes done. Westerners always wear our clothes. We don't want to, we want pieces of work. They called them art frames, and we want things for the wall. Which was totally against what the museum wanted, and it was an interesting negotiation for a year. And so they won. It was their show, and all I felt like I was just the translator. I had all their conversations and what they wanted to do and how they wanted the show looked. I brought it back here, had it all translated. Museum all agreed, went back there with the translation and said to them, had that translated back into their language from the English. And they were like, no, that's not what we said. That's not what we wanted. We're like, are you serious? So I had to go back, and we had so many conversations about what it was, how they saw themselves. And I thought, one curator actually quit over it, but the other curator stayed. And I thought the Vancouver Museum did an amazing job of this show, and it was called Through the Eye of the Needle. So when they saw that booklet back, they're pointing at it like, that's me, that's my stitch, that's, oh my God, that's Megaband stitch, oh, this is, and so they're just all talking about the show, which for some reason, half of them, even as the show was coming up, and we had the posters and everything, and what we went to one group of villages, and they were like, so this show in Africa, when, and it's like, in Africa, it's in Canada, God, and you know, if it's not in U.S., they're just like, oh, so where's Canada again? And I think they looked at Cameroon, and so anyhow, so it was an amazing journey for us to go on. The museum had wanted us to identify all their stitches, which is always very interesting, because that's quite what a museum wants, but it's not necessarily how stitches and language works. The museum wanted everything identified. And they have all different reasons for putting thing, one thing, saying one thing. And I have a wonderful part of the show I had agreed to get them all together. Some of them have to travel 8 hours on a bus to get to the one little town, Bouge. And I have this great shot, a great video clip of them where I said, okay, if you guys all come, we'll get in lunch. I'll order in lunch and we'll have lunch and dinner. So then I said, but you know, before we do this, the museum wants to know what this image is, what this is, and so one of them, they're saying, oh, it's a cat. No, it's not. The other woman's saying, no, it's a peacock. Another woman says, no, it's a tube light. Another woman says, are you buying us lunch or what? And it was just so great, just how they saw them. You know, stitches move and language moves, and sometimes we want to place things in a certain way. And they were like they just move and they think so differently from our Western way, that trying to get a show that actually expressed that and reflected that was really interesting. But it was, I think the museum did a very good job. They're very proud of that show and that book.
Wonderful. I think that brings us to time. You may want to remind them it's Dr. Fussy Pushy now.
Yes. Just...
Thanks to you, Effie. So I'd like to call Dr. Everett up, and he's going to present you with a thank you gift.
Well, Dr. Charllotte, you fulfilled my expectations. I'm sure you've provoked some thinking here in this room, and well beyond this room in your many other presentations. I'm sure that all of us looked at that documentary and there was something that stood out that captured it all. For me, it was the young man towards the end of the documentary, the young man folding the garment and ironing it, and I was watching the way he handled this with care, this precious piece. He clearly recognized the value in it. It was as if he was holding some very delicate living organism. And I thought that, for me, captured well this notion of the value that's portrayed here in these products. I think you've shown us that much as we're inclined to think, well, we've got Westerners going over to a developing country and producing clothing or taking clothing that's produced locally for sale over here in some exploitative way. But I think you've also shown us how that can be done in a way that's truly respectful of the process, but primarily the people and the families and the tradition and the culture. So. On behalf of the University of the Fraser Valley, I want to thank you for today's lecture. I want to thank you for the time you've been spending with our students and our faculty and staff. I know you've got a busy day planned tomorrow. We shamelessly exploit you when you come to the campus. Oh, look at that! Right behind me, it magically appears. I want to thank you on behalf of the University of the Fraser Valley for your extraordinary work, and for sharing that with us, for sharing yourself with us. Thank you, Charllotte.